We previously discussed the reactions to the Great Fire of London, and you can check out that video here. But with the fire finally coming to an end after 4 days of panic, what happened next? Here are three major developments that came from the fire's aftermath. From September 2nd to September 6, 1666, a great fire raged through the streets of London. Only one-fifth of the town was left standing. Virtually all the civic buildings had been destroyed, as well as more than 13,000 private dwellings. This map here shows the damage quite well. The white areas are all ruins, and the labelled buildings amongst the white were predominantly buildings that were destroyed. 89 parish churches, the Royal Exchange, Guildhall, St Paul's Cathedral were all lost, and costs to rebuild totaled about £10 million. Now, London had nowhere near the money needed to rebuild immediately. It actually took over 30 years to rebuild what they had lost. Temporary housing was created, however, it wasn't great. They were ill-equipped to deal with the influx of people, and diseases spread quite quickly, again through this housing and especially during the harsh winter that followed. Many people were financially ruined after the fire, and unfortunately a lot of the population actually ended up in debtors' prisons, which were just as overcrowded. So Christopher Wren was given the task of rebuilding London and into the city that you might recognise today. But before that, several people proposed possible plans for the rebuild. Richard Newcourt proposed a grid system, with each square containing a church. Interestingly, Newcourt's ideas also involved demolishing parts of London that were actually spared in the fire, so not many people wanted to go with that option. John Evelyn also proposed a rebuilding plan, which included long straight streets and large squares. He claimed it would make London fitter for commerce, apter for government, sweeter for health, and more glorious for beauty. And here we have Christopher Wren's proposed plan. He also went with long wide streets and large squares, with the buildings in neat blocks. However, despite all these proposals for improving the city, Wren's exact design here was actually never used, and the government opted for the easier and cheaper option of pretty much copying exactly how London was already laid out. He was appointed to be one of the architectural commissioners, overseeing the rebuilding of the city. And Wren famously rebuilt St Paul's Church and 52 of the city churches. He also redesigned Oxford, the library at Trinity College, and the Royal Hospital at Chelsea. Many also say that the Great Fire of London helped cleanse the city after a disastrous summer of plague in 1666. The dirty, overcrowded, diseased streets were destroyed, and in their place they built the great city. But in reality, disease remained, and overcrowded areas were even more prominent as they were rebuilding the town. So even though the Great Fire offered an opportunity for a fresh new start, they didn't really take on board that opportunity and just created another replica of exactly what they had, with a few upgrades. Before the fire, people were not as aware of the dangers of fire. Not to say that there weren't fires before this, but this one was particularly devastating. London in September of 1666 was in prime condition for a devastating fire. London was one of the largest cities in Europe at the time, with 350,000 people living in the city. So you can barely imagine what a highly packed and tight living area it was. The streets were not designed or planned and were incredibly narrow. Buildings were mostly made of timber and were covered in a flammable material called pitch and roofed with thatch. Houses were almost built on top of each other, so we see a lot of houses leaning out over the streets and almost touching each other. So if a fire started, it didn't really have a chance to die out before it found another house to catch alight. On top of this, the summer of 1666 was long, hot and dry. The days of September happened to be particularly dry and windy. London was also filled with animals, especially horses, And as well as houses, there were just as many storerooms filled with hay and straw. As the fire moved towards the River Thames, it also hit some of the larger warehouses stocked with oil and tallow, more flammable material. So, pretty perfect conditions. After the Great Fire, the King made some new rules in the Rebuilding Act of 1667. These are the City of London's regulations for building after the fire. New buildings had to have brick fronts, houses next to each other were to be the same height, signs were not to hang over the street but had to be fixed to the wall, passages and alleys also got a special mention. And the court is consenting and desirous that all straight and narrow passages, which shall be found convenient for common benefit and accommodation, and shall receive His Majesty's order and approbation, shall and may be enlarged and made wider. Surveyors suddenly also had a lot more responsibility. Each plot had to be surveyed by the city surveyors, who set out the foundations and lines of the walls. It is ordered that no builder shall lay his foundation until the surveyors, or one of them, shall view it, and that a person observe the surveyor's directions concerning the superstructure to be erected over the said foundations. No building was allowed until the builder had registered their name with the city authorities and paid 6 shillings and 8 pence fee. But this far from eliminated the dangers of fire, and several more did break out over the centuries. The third major development coming after the Fire of London was fire insurance. Prior to 1666, there was no fire brigade. People just acted as firefighters as and when a fire broke out, with no training or skill involved. They had water pumps, but these were all hand pumps with little water pressure, range or capacity. So they would mostly rely on buckets and lots of people to carry them and chuck water on the fire, which might work if it was one house on fire and if it's caught fast enough. One of the main ways they would fight a quickly spreading fire was destroying the buildings in the path of the fire to stop it in its tracks, hence the use of gunpowder. Fun fact, the Great Fire didn't spread south of the river because of an earlier 1633 fire on London Bridge. There actually used to be houses all across the bridge, but houses along the middle section were burnt and torn down, and luckily not rebuilt in time, because it was this gap that stopped the fire from spreading any further. After the fire, businessmen see this golden opportunity. They began to offer insurance to those who paid as a surety for next time in the case of property loss. Then they stepped in to organise firefighters to get paid for a job and invested more into firefighting equipment. Thus the fire brigade was invented, not to stop devastation but to stop fires for an insurance sake. A fire mark could be put on your house to prove that your insurance was paid. There would be many different marks from different insurance companies, and some of these can still be seen on houses today. So if a fire happened, different brigades would show up, and if they didn't see their company's mark, they would just leave the property to burn. So you better hope that you paid the right company, who would get there the fastest. Permanent city-run fire departments did not come until the 18th century. So there we have it, 3 things that developed from the Great Fire of London. Thank you so much for watching. Please make sure to subscribe if you haven't, and let us know down in the comments what other topics you'd like us to dive into next. See you next time, and goodbye for now.